that image of what was left of that pig after a few weeks, whatever. So that makes me wonder what the condition of Gabby's body was. And I'm like, I don't want to be disrespectful, especially to her family, but just in the sake of trying to understand the evidence that they may have been able to collect. You know, the cause of death that they found was manual strangulation. And there are telltale signs of manual strangulation that we all know as true crime nerds. One of them is like a broken hyoid bone. There are other cartilages in the neck that are broken. And so at that point, like at the stage, that last stage of the pig carcass that you just showed us, those things would be evident, right? But maybe like petechiae in the eyes, they never would see that because the eyes would be gone at that point, right? Yeah.
Eyes would be the very first thing to go. Always.
So if he strangled her manually, which is what they ruled, that means that he used his hands, right? He didn't use a garrote or a ligature or something like that. I guess in investigations these days, and this kind of goes into another realm where you're an expert in the realm of DNA, we know that there is such thing as touch DNA. Like if somebody grabs me by the neck, it's possible that they left skin cells or sweat or oils from their hands on my neck. And that DNA may be able to be, processed, I guess is the word that I would think of. But in the case of Gabby Petito, if she were in the same condition as that pig carcass, would they be able to get, foreign DNA off of her body?
That's a good question. Again, not being a forensic geneticist, they've got great tools, but I can't see, number one, how it would still be around. Now, DNA is very robust. It'll stand the test of time. It'll hang out for a long time in the right conditions. Dry is really good. Dry is really good for preserving DNA because you don't get a lot of excess bacteria and other things like that that'll chew it up. You want things dry, but hot is bad for DNA. Dry, cold, obviously the very best. And hot and wet's kind of the worst for preserving DNA outdoors. So I can't see anything off her skin because I imagine that there's, you know, again, I don't know the exact conditions. Her skin may have been preserved. It may not have had the right insects at the time there. There may have been some skin, but at the same time, it's hard to say what would you get out of that? We know she was with Brian Laundrie for a long time, for weeks and weeks. A defense could easily say, well, yeah, his DNA's there because they were hanging out together all the time. He touched her all the time. They were supposedly together and dating and everything like that. So that wouldn't be definitive of anything that I could imagine. The only thing I could think of is the thought being, let's try and collect DNA samples to see if anybody else DNA hits, if we find someone else that was possibly there, you know, around her in the last little bit. I looked at a few resources earlier today. I was trying to figure it out, and I found a couple of cool papers that were trying to experiment with how long DNA might last. I'll read you a couple little snippets that I found interesting. It said, above all, it depends on whether DNA is exposed to heat, water, sunlight, and oxygen. If a body is left out in the sun and rain, its DNA will be useful for testing for only a few weeks. If it's buried a few feet below ground, the DNA will last for 1,000 to 10,000 years. If it's frozen Antarctic ice, it could last a few hundred thousand years. So they're saying with a body, even her body might be difficult to get much DNA out of, let alone trace or touch DNA, right? Another experiment they did. Sorry, go ahead.
No, well, I was just going to say that if Dr. Brent Blue said that they used DNA in their investigation, maybe it's more realistic to conclude that they used DNA to test to make sure that it was her, like it was an identifying of her, not necessarily gathering evidence against her killer.
Yeah. If it was a hair is, which presumably if they're together, a hair would be a lot easier to get DNA out of. They've taken DNA out of hair that's frozen in the tundra for 20,000 years. So hair would last, probably preserving DNA inside of it for that period of time. Another one, just to, as we're talking clothes and things, this was an interesting study. They put DNA, trace amounts of DNA on clothes, and now they put them in water rather than out in the dry desert. But in this one, they said the long exposure time still resulting in a complete profile was 2 weeks for sample with skin cells in the pond during winter. In the summer, the time period for erasing the bulk of DNA was 4 hours regarding epithelial samples for more than 1 day or blood samples in the pond and river environments. So in the summer, now granted that's in water, and water is going to have more biological activity going on that can break it down. In fact, interestingly enough, that's one of the big research projects I have going on right now is looking at the presence of eDNA in water in the Great Lakes to try and identify invasive species through environmental DNA. That's what eDNA is. So we're trying to figure out how fast it breaks down. And we're finding it breaks down fairly quickly, but again, that's in water. This last one says experimental results demonstrate the ability to recover DNA from human cells on outdoor surfaces decreases significantly over 2 weeks. Personally, no clear trends were identified for casework data, indicating that many other factors are involved affecting the recovery of trace DNA. Nevertheless, to ensure that valuable trace evidence is not lost, it's recommended that crime scenes are processed expeditiously.